both Butoh and street dance have so many similarities. I mean, from around, they were both started in similar time periods. But at least in my mind, they both come from this idea of revolution, right? On the Butoh side, the revolution against, you know, West ideals resulting from the Western occupation, and then also traditional Japanese beauty ideals. And then on the street dance side, also that kind of revolution, revolting against the ideas of what was termed aesthetically pleasing at the time. And then they both have these different connections in terms of the erasure of the self, you know, Butoh, depending on who you ask, with the white powder representing representing the atomic bomb, asking for the atomic bomb, but also this idea of emptying the self to be able to transform into another idea. And then street dance on the other side, you know, having Black and Latinos in the Bronx trying to fight against the erasure of their culture and the gentrification of their neighborhoods. So there's a lot of different like connects that I find in there. But what I'm trying to work toward establishing in terms of my like longer term dance style is something that both draws from these styles physically, but also somatically and also psychologically too. You know, something that has like Kōmu Boshi said, like, you know, it's like this balance, like the dance is the balance, the balancing is dancing, right? So trying to find this like inner balance of the inner mind states, like your inner psyche, but also physically. And I think Butoh does a really great job of pulling all of these parts of your inner psyche from the inside to the outside. And then street dance kind of has this external idea that then retranslates to the inside. So it's like trying to find this like circularity between both of them that combines to create some kind of new style and aesthetic.
When I go to Europe or I go to North America, all the dancers, when they start to study my choreography, different part of the body start to have pain than usual choreography that they're doing. Because I think my choreography is very down, my weight has to be down. This is, I think, finding out it's a lot to do with me being agricultural based people, not nomadic people. That makes any sense? You guys are riding a horse while we are planting the rice. And this is in my gene that it puts my weight down.
Interesting.
And without me being a conscious, that information that I have in my DNA comes out when I start to do something. Or like my choreography has a lot of movement with the arms. I never realized this with myself, but when I was choreographing in Geneva, when I was younger, one of the principal dancers there, his name is Mark Kwan, he came up to me, he said, Toru, I can never remember all the movement you do with your arms. You have so much movement with the arms. I never realized this myself. But then later I was speaking with one of the prince of Japan. He passed away, unfortunately, Prince Takamado. And he mentioned to me, he said, Toru-san, any culture which is agricultural based people, their dance has so much movement with the arms. Because in olden days, people had to dance in a rice field. So the legs were stuck in mud. So the culture naturally led them to use their arms to connect with a god, you know. But all the nomadic people, they use a lot of legs to dance. Their legs were free. So without me being conscious, when I started to do choreography, all that things comes out. So it's nothing that, you know, that it's not in here, but it's really in my body, I think.
Sayo-san and I think, met for the first time this morning, that morning of this show. And we just, she brought work from Shimazaki Sensei, and I brought part of my solo, which you saw clips of in the other video. But we just showed up and we were like, hi, I'm this person. And she's like, hi, I'm this person. And we just connected over the course of an hour or so, made a little bit together, and then put it together for an evening show. It was just a kind of a wild ride of an experience, and obviously a very early stages as to what the potential of the collaboration would be, but I just want to give props to Sayo-san. So I think the first time I went to Japan in college, and I was the like one of two Black people I think I saw for the first 6 weeks I was there. You really start to think back, think about yourself and like where you place in a cultural, in a wider global cultural context. Mm-hmm. I think it just kind of helped awaken me to a greater contextual placing of my own identity. And both of my own art making, but also in how the art that I make is seen on a wider context outside of just where I was in college. I think it just brought an awareness of like, oh, this is actually who I am. This is actually how I'm seen from the outside. Mm-hmm. And an awareness that I am being seen from the outside.
Me, of course, I'm Japanese, but educated in Canada a long time, and I worked in Europe and all. But just like, look at Japan, there's McDonald's there, 7-Eleven, you know, like everybody think McDonald's, 7-Eleven are Japanese, or these Japanese kids. They thought, they went to America, they were so shocked, there's a McDonald's there, you know, like, so our culture is so mixed now that you know, so I'm not living in a samurai era, right? Mm-hmm. So me being a Japanese means that I am a Japanese who eat hamburger, you know, and eat sushi sometime. Like it's all completely mixed. And if I try to be as honest as I can in my choreography, that should come out. That I am quarter of me is almost like American, you know, not because I went abroad. It's just living in here.
One of the really exciting and magical things about dance in particular is that, you know, even when you're dancing as a member of an ensemble, what you're presenting in your own body is so personal, right? Because everybody is going to be a little bit different, even if you're in complete unison. Everybody's going to be a little bit different. Everybody comes from a very different movement background. And then this also, you know, obviously comes from a very different personal background. So part of what creating an ensemble, creating those kind of intangible bonds that you can experience between performers on stage is, like I mentioned before, those performers getting to actually know each other. So that we don't come to that final performance and all I know is just your name. Right. So understanding how one body interacts, right? If both sides are attempting to learn the same thing, right? There's going to be a push and pull in terms of what one body can do versus another, because our body types are going to be very different and our backgrounds will be very different. So there has to be a middle meeting ground, right? Both physically, but also, you know, there's interchange between the stories. So I have to know this person and where this person comes from and what this person has been through in order to better understand why and how their body is moving that way. Mm. Right. And then the same thing has to happen vice versa. And so we, by the time we get to this ending point, we know more about each other than just our name and our favorite food. We know what is created, what experiences have created this person that we're dancing alongside.
Dance should express something that cannot be expressed by words. That is the most valuable part of dance. But yet, some of the greatest piece of choreography, they have a power of this being a narrative. Unless, like a ballet, you know, unless you're doing a story thing, we are not sure if we're able to do it with this production. We're aiming for, I don't know if we can do it, because it's something that it's, as a choreographer, it's one of the most, I think, difficult goal to reach, being narrative in your piece somehow. Very difficult. The creator's depth as a person. You can only reach this area when you live life fully. That's the only thing make it possible.
You know, I'm not asking them to be Japanese, right? And I'm also not prescribing culture or prescribing history in the works that I'm making, right? I'm not making works and I'm saying like, this is how it is, or this is how it should be. I'm not doing that in my works. What I'm doing in my works is taking specific aspects and then using those as jumping off points for adding my own personal context and experience. And some of those delve deeper into the language and culture than others. But I also come at it from my now 16 years of engaged study, of embodied study of the language and of the culture. But I don't expect my dancers to speak as if they have lived these experiences that I have lived, or speak as if they have lived these experiences that Japanese people may have experienced and lived, right? Mm-hmm. I'm giving them these tools as artistic jumping off points in the same way they are for me in my choreography, without prescribing how things should be or how things are for a culture that's not my own. Mm-hmm.